Salutations and welcome to Glitch Bottle, the podcast where we uncork the uncommon in magic, mysticism, and the generally misunderstood. I'm Alexander F., and today on the podcast, we are so excited to welcome scholar, researcher, and Sufi mystic, Sheikh Waheed Azal. Waheed is the founder of the Sufi Fatimiyya order, and he's made history by engaging in groundbreaking talks with the Grand Ayatollah in Iran, of all people, a few years back. In this podcast, Waheed helps us uncover the shimmering jewels of Sufi mysticism. He discusses altered states of consciousness, the concept of infinite love in Sufism and what that means, the Islamic Seven Seals of Solomon, which is also known as the greatest name and its magical implications, how Solomonic and Western magic relates to magical practice in the Islamic world, the difference between Islamic theurgistic magic or ruhaniyya and goetic magic, known as sihr in Arabic, and so many more topics. And now to help us uncork the uncommon, I give you Sheikh Waheed Azal. Waheed, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, and ahlan wa sahlan, welcome to the Glitch Bottle podcast.
Thank you very much. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Good to be on your show.
Can you share a little bit about your background and when you first started on your spiritual path? I heard that you were sharing before that when you were 18 years old, your spiritual trajectory was changed forever by a special book that you came across in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
it started not with a book, but with a plant. Let me just preface that first by saying that, you know, every human being is on a spiritual journey from the moment that they come into the material world and even prior to it. I grew up in a fairly secularized Iranian Baha'i family, were basically a product of the Pahlavi years. But as a child, I remember, you know, I recollect many paranormal experiences. And we had one side of our family from my father's side, so we were very deeply connected to the Sheikhi school, which is a very esoteric strand of Twelver Shiism. In any case, I would say probably from around the age of 7 to 15, the secularization, especially after we left Iran following the 1979 revolution, the secular narrative of life became the predominant narrative, and this went on until pretty much my 18th birthday. And on my 18th birthday, a very dear friend of mine took me out into the starry December New Mexico sky and literally initiated me into the mushrooms, to the psilocybin mushrooms. And that experience literally tweaked my entire perspective on reality. Up until that point, my intellectual interests have been, you know, very left-wing. I was, you know, mainly interested in Marxism, in European philosophies, etc. Nothing really interested in God in the bigger picture, metaphysics, magic, none of this. But that experience was pivotal. And a few days afterwards, my uncle and I were getting a car fixed, an old car that I was going to drive as I was about to enter college. We took it to a garage way on the backside of town, out in the middle of nowhere, and we made a mistake of not having breakfast, and the mechanic wanted to work on the car pretty much the whole day, so we were stranded in this place the whole day. Without any food or water, and we were both basically starving, and I don't know what possessed me, literally possessed me, but out of the blue, I just suddenly said Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which was not part of my diction at that age, or at the time at all, in the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. It didn't take 30 seconds. This van drove into the parking lot of this mechanics garage, and it was this guy who was promoting his new restaurant, new Mexican restaurant in Albuquerque, and he literally fed me and my uncle. And something, you know, it's like, okay, something has happened as a result of this experience I had with the spores a few nights before that. And a few days after that, probably about a little less than a week, I walked into a bookstore near the University of New Mexico, found on the shelf this book by the great eminent French Iranologist, Henri Corbin, entitled Spiritual Body and Celestial Earth from Mazdian Iran to Shiite Iran. I bought it, took it home, read it all the way through, didn't understand most of what he was talking about on the first reading, But this book then became basically the orientation for the spirituality that was going to evolve over the next 20 years or so.
From the first situation you were in Bismillah Rahman Rahim to this book, did you feel, Waheed, that you were kind of fulfilling some kind of thing that you were always meant to do in kind of a cosmic sense?
I absolutely think there's also an ancestral element to this that I only found out about much later on when I made a bayat with the Iranian Sufi sheikh. And he really broke down my family history from, you know, bits and pieces that I told him. Because of what happened in Iran when you had the Pahlavi government come in the 1920s, they basically began to de-Islamicize culturally rather than, not even, but completely. It was a huge cultural project to basically create a modern secular state in Iran. And they pushed all forms of religiosity in the background, even persecuting a lot of religious people at the time. My family was a product of that. They were the middle class, the secular middle class of the Pahlavi years. And so there was a break. And somewhere along the line, this threat had to be rethreaded, as it were. And I became, I guess, the spirit's guinea pig to that end. So things happened the way they happened.
Obviously, right now, so many people know you as the founder of the Fatlamiya Sufi order. But can you talk about, in general, your initial contact with Sufism proper in terms of who you met, how you got into it?
I had been looking for a teacher pretty much after these initial experiences. And I was tariqa hopping for quite a while, and I really didn't connect to what I was finding in the United States at the time. And around 1993, the brother of a very dear friend of mine in Albuquerque came to Albuquerque, New Mexico. And he happened to be a sheikh of a sub-branch of the Nimatullahi order, not the Nimatullahi order of the Nurbakhsh group, but another sub-branch of this order. And he also had ijazat, permissions from the Khaksar order, which is a very hyper Shiite order, as well as the Qadiris, order that's very prominent in Kurdistan, Iranian Kurdistan, and also in Turkey. And I was initiated by this gentleman. He was unfortunately very ill, was terminal with cancer, so his time was very limited with me. It was only about 6 years. But interesting enough, before he died in 98, he gave a permission to myself and a few other people, not so much as his successor, but to basically have the permission that once we were mature enough and confident enough in our spiritual maturity, that we would have the right to initiate other people in the teachings that he had given us. And one of the central things that he gave to me specifically was a practice involving meditation with this symbol called the Greatest Name, which is also known as the Seven Seals. And he said to me before he passed on, he says that now that I'm gone, you know, you don't really need a physical human teacher. This symbol will be your sheikh, will be your teacher, your murshid from here on out. Basically following what he told me to do ever since. And during this time from his death, I encountered ayahuasca. I told a friend of mine in Iran about ayahuasca, and he had told me that the group of these Khaksar Sufis that my sheikh was affiliated with were also working with plant entheogens. These are a group of Khaksar Sufis that live in Mazandaran province, which is a very foresty, very beautiful, natural part of Iran. So I went in 2003. I went to Iran, and I connected with this group of Khaksar dervishes and had a ceremony with them. They swore me to secrecy, and they would not tell me what plants that they were using. But I am pretty confident about at least one of the components of the plant concoction, which was the Syrian rue, the Isfahan, as we call it in Iran. And there was definitely a tryptamine involved. And that region of Iran is known for having very rich species of Mimosa hostilis all throughout the forest.
You are known as the founder of the Fatlamiya Sufi order, but before we get into the order specifically and the being of Fatima herself, could you please, just for our listeners, Waheed, can you give just a very brief overview of Sunni Islam, which most people have heard of? It's the predominant, you know, branch of Islam. Shia Islam, which of course is predominant in Iran and Iraq. Sufism, in terms of how it either fits into these two areas or outside of these two areas.
All of these are happening at the same time. Sufism as a phenomena is basically the mystical dimension of Islam. However, the mystical dimension of Islam from the point of view of Shia Muslims has its genesis in the family of the Prophet himself. And this namely being with his son-in-law and cousin, Ali ibn Abi Talib, who us Shiites believe to have been the successors of the Prophet Muhammad and also the first among the awliya or the walis, the providential guides. So if the position or if the rank of Prophet, or Nabi, has been sealed according to the Quran, another function, as it were, was unsealed. And this was the initiation. If the revelation ended, then the initiation began with Ali. Sunni Islam does not really subscribe to this point of view unless they are Sufis. And within the Sufism of the Sunni world, there's a phenomena of love for the Ahl al-Bayt, the people of the house. But they don't take that extra step, as it were, to look at the initiation being completely contained within the family of the house of the Prophet. Now, this symbol that I mentioned before, the greatest thing, or the seven seals in Islam and in Sufism and Shiism specifically, is a symbol that is transmitted directly by Ali, the first Imam of Shiism. So the magic, the theurgy, all of this, in a sense, is concentrated around the figure of Ali and his progeny.
One of the things that you talk about and that is central to Sufism is this concept of dhikr, or remembrance, yes, of the law of God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you talk about this, Waheed, in terms of, for someone who maybe is not familiar at all, what is this concept of dhikr all about?
The concept of dhikr has many, the word itself has many connotations. It's also, you can translate it as remembrance. So there's a verse in the Quran, Adhkaruni adhkurkum, remember me and I will remember you. The word also denotes invocation. Adhkaruni adhkurkum can also mean invoke me and I will invoke you. So there's, you know, the dhakir, the one who is invoking God, is being invoked back by God, as it were.
Wow.
It is basically the we find the names and attributes of God that are in the Quran and out and in the prayers of the Imams and the Prophet and his family to be endowed with incredible spiritual magical potency. Around this concept of the zikr, there's also the very important aspect of the gematria involved with these zikrs. So, for example, take the name Allah, which is 66 in the gematria, or the abjad. So a given Sufi will sit after Salat and recite this name 66 times to its numerical value. This is the zikr. The zikr is the meat. It is the fluid, as it were. It is the animating power, the transmission of the initiation, without which, you know, you're basically, there is no initiation as such. And it, every initiation that happens in any tariqah, the first thing that a sheikh gives to the murid is their zikr. Now, this zikr could be an actual word that they're meant to utter. In fact, some Sufi orders tell their murids to draw the name with their imaginal finger within their heart. So, for example, so a given murid is given the name Allah as their initiatic zikr. And they're told by the sheikh, well, from here on out, every day after Salat, you will write this name with your imaginal finger on your heart 66 times.
When it comes to dhikr and the names of Allah proper, are there 99 names? Is that
no,
right?
No, there are more than 99. There's 99 that... Oh, yeah. There are 99 that appear in the Quran.
Ah, okay.
But, you know, there's a lot more names that are extrapolated from that in the prayers. Like I said, of the Imams, of the Ahl al-Bayt, you know, there's one particular prayer that is used during Ramadan, which I use all the time. It's called the Dua Joshan al-Kabir, the prayer of the greater coat steel of mail, which is a prayer believed to have been given to the Prophet by Gabriel, the Archangel Gabriel, during the Battle of Badr. And there's 1,000 names and attributes of God invoked in this prayer. It's a prayer of approximately 100 verses, about 16 pages, and there's 1,000 names and attributes.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So
one particular one I think that a lot of your goddess-centric listeners might be interested in. There's a word in Arabic called kala, and kala means to protect. And in the 60th verse of this prayer, Allah is invoked by the name of Kali. Du'a Joshin al-Kabir, it says the verse is, Ya Kali man istiklahu, O the protector who bestows protection from the one who asks of it.
Waheed, so there's these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and something that I think a lot of people in quote-unquote Western esotericism might resonate with is the Hebrew names or Greek names that are used in a magical context. They are vibrated to kind of, you know, raise the consciousness of the aspirant or of the operator, so to speak. What purpose do the names specifically serve? Obviously, it is, you know, dhikr, it is remembrance. But as you said, are they really used to kind of raise the consciousness of the individual practitioner?
Absolutely. Before, and I will also tell you this. In a lot of the prayers attributed to the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt, you have the Hebrew names of God within the Arabic zikr. So you have prayers by Ali alayhi salam where the Tetragrammaton is invoked. I translate actually one of these from the Bihar al-Anwar and put it on my blog about 2 years ago.
Oh, wow. That is incredible. So there's that kind of cross-pollination that's happened.
Yeah. This happens a lot. There is a lot of Jewish-Islamic cross-pollinization that was going on. I mean, just remember, the lots of Jews were living in the Islamic Empire, various parts of the Islamic, for pretty much the entirety of that period, in the medieval, in Andalusia, in North Africa, in Iran. Some of these Jewish communities are some of the oldest Jewish communities in the world.
There's one other concept that I would love to talk to you about, which is the vital element in Sufism that I'm overjoyed to hear your perspective on, is the concept of al-hub, or love, and the divine love, and how one approaches. We always hear in Sufism of kind of this one-on-one relationship with the beloved, my beloved. So, Waheed, can you talk about this kind of overwhelming force of love or hub in not only your order, but in Sufism as in general? What does this mean?
You go back to a hadith, Qudsi, one of the extra Quranic sayings of God that is much beloved to Sufis everywhere, Sunni and Shia, where God is asked by the Prophet David, you know, why did you create the world? You know, what was the purpose of creation? And the response is, Kuntu kenzan makhfiyan fa'ahbabtu an arif fa'alatu l'kakei l'arif. I was a hidden treasure and I desired or loved to be known, therefore I created creation in order to be known.
Wow.
So the very impulse of the creative will of the divine in pre-creation, in pre-eternity, was the very impulse by which the aspirant is then looking at the creator itself. God created the world with hope, and it is the path of hope that then links the aspirant to God again, the great beloved.
In so many spiritual systems, there's, you know, hub, for instance, kind of represents, as you say, this kind of overwhelming, spiritual, highly elevated force that just overpowers everything. And then on the other side, you have something like fiqh, or this kind of Islamic jurisprudence, which is when someone thinks of powerful, overwhelming, emanationist kind of consciousness-expanding stuff, they might not necessarily think of fiqh, you know? They might think of...
Yeah, I do agree with that. I agree. And it's very unfortunate that Islam took this route. I mean, there's a historical accident or whatever you want to call it, where Islam went into this direction from the Shia point of view, and maybe not the Shia point of view of the Hawza, the seminary, but the Shia point of view of a lot of Shia Gnostics, and even in the text, in the hadith of the Shia. Things went in this direction. The exotericism took over because of the rejection of the community of the wilaya, of the providential guides, by insurgency of Ali. Because with the revelation, there was supposed to be a complementary initiation, and the Ahlul Bayt represented, embodied that initiation. And because the Ahlul Bayt was rejected in their rightful place as the leaders of the Ummah, then the exotericism, it's as if God said, okay, you know, you don't want the truth in its completeness, well, you know, keep it in its facade. This has been the path of Islam, and I would also argue Rabbinic Judaism as well. Henri Corbin made this profound statement that I absolutely agree with, and he phrased it in the context of the church, and he basically said the church is Ahriman, the church is the devil. You could say that the same thing about, you know, the mosque or the hauza or the synagogue, because it is constricting with laws, right? And I'm not dissing the Sharia or law as such. We're not antinomian here, because there is a necessity for rules and principles and guidelines to follow. But
sure.
This obsession that arises in the Abrahamic traditions and also in some of the other traditions with law and jurisprudence is basically, in my opinion and the opinion of many Sufis, a concerted effort to veil from the spirit, whereas the impulse of the revelation itself is to unveil the individual to the spirit.
Would the motivations be like many large organizations? One could think of Christianity and the Catholic Church. One could think of other groups where the idea is, if you keep people in kind of a cage of spiritual constipation, let's say, where you're just kind of there, you show up every week, you kind of do your thing, and you're not really questioning. If you keep people there, is it that therefore you can perpetuate certain existing power systems?
That's the basic impulse. Absolutely. It's politics. It's human politics. It's the age old story of power. You know, when the prophet dies, these old Arab nobles, some of whom who had been at the opposite side fighting the Muslims for 20 years and then switched side and declared their allegiance to Muhammad, suddenly found a huge vacuum in the absence of the prophet. And even though Ali had been nominated explicitly and publicly as the prophet's successor, once the prophet was gone, these people basically did whatever they want and pushed the family of the prophet aside completely and did this to themselves, basically. I mean, this is the Shiite point of view. Now, with Shiism itself does also then tend to go in that same ossifying, hyper-exoteric direction pretty much after the period of what we believe is called the Greater Occultation, when the 12th Imam goes into permanent hiding. And what happens is what sociologists call the routinization of charisma. This process of the routinization of charisma then takes a hold of Shiism itself, and the tradition of the Hauza or the seminary and the scholars. And some of these scholars were great people, but they begin to straitjacket the tradition into the form that we find it today. And not all of the esoteric teachings and the transmissions were lost, but they were pushed aside. And some of the things that these guys didn't like, they found expedient to either try to discredit or deny. And it's endless. But yet, even today, within the Hauza, within the seminary system, there are some amazing mystics from amongst the Ayatollahs and the Mullahs themselves. Not all of them are completely closed-minded jurisprudents. Some of them are very interesting, is that they spend a whole life studying the jurisprudence, and then they break through that barrier. And the jurisprudence, out of the jurisprudence comes the ma'rifa, the gnosis, you know. And they begin to study the texts of great, you know, Sufis like Ibn Arabi, and philosopher mystics like Mullah Sadra, etc. And Ayatollah Khomeini was apparently one of these people. He not only taught jurisprudence, he also taught the mystics. He was a great lover of Rumi and Hafiz, taught the philosophy of Mullah Sadra, and was very deep in the theosophy of Ibn Arabi and his school.
Something that I really have been looking forward to discuss with you, among many things, which is the incredible work that you've done yourself and a handful of individuals in Iran. You basically got together with some like-minded individuals, and you, for 18 months, were engaged with the office of the Grand Ayatollah Sayyid Mohammad Sadegh Husseini Rouhani in Iran. So you were engaged trying to petition or seek a kind of either a formal legal ruling known as a fatwa or some kind of determination from one of the highest offices in the land regarding the use of entheogens and psychoactive or psychedelic substances in certain contexts. Can you share about this whole, it's just a fascinating story.
Yeah, it's a great story. I mean, I was approached by one particular individual in Lebanon, you know, who knew about my what the Fatimiyya was about and my interest in entheogens and ayahuasca. And, you know, he had been basically starting on that journey himself. And he said, you know, we should start petitioning some of the leading clerics in Najaf in Iraq. And if they don't respond, we should go to the ones in Qom in Iran and see which one of them will at least tell us something, so we can gauge at least what the position, the legal jurisprudential position of the seminary may be on these plats, because we know what the Sunnis will make of this. Haram immediately. But because of previous, the precedents around things such as, in Iran, for example, there's a tradition with opium. And there have been many fatwas, both pro and con, from the seminary about opium. And there are many mullahs, many ayatollahs of the past who were known to regularly smoke opium. You know, Ayatollah Tabatabai was an exceptional example of this, great philosopher of the 20th century. So we wrote to various offices. They wrote to various offices. I was kind of in the background, supplying some of the text and information and discussion and brainstorming, as it were. And eventually they wrote to the office of Grand Ayatollah Rouhani, who is considered a source of emulation, the Majlis Taqlid. And his office was very receptive immediately to the first emails that they sent. And for 18 months, there was a long discussion. They wanted information. They wanted everything broken down for them. These messages were being taken directly to the Ayatollah himself. He wanted to know everything that there was to know about, about the ayahuasca. These guys translated great chunks out of Benny Shannon's book for him, and various articles, testimonies. We linked them to videos, and this went on for 18 months. And in March of 2014, he basically issued a very short one-page fatwa that said that as long as these are administered under qualified experts, that there is really nothing in the fiqh that can prohibit their use. So technically these are halal. I mean, we explained to him the visionary component, that people have visions of heaven and hell. We tried to, basically get out of the discussion of the word hallucination and contextualize in the form of vision. And he was completely okay with it. He said, well, we cannot rule this haram. Number one, because per the fiqh of Shiism, the jurisprudence of Shiism, whatever naturally that is occurring, okay, is by definition halal. Okay, it could be makruh in the sense that it's not fit for human consumption, but on a legal ruling, it cannot be ruled haram. So by definition, these things are halal, with the caveats that people should be responsible, etc., and should seek qualified experts if they decide to do these things. And this is pretty big. We tested it again. My two friends, they went to a minor cleric in Lebanon and got the, just blindly put the same questions to him, and he ruled exactly the same thing. So the principles, at least in Shia fiqh, are pretty straightforward where these five movement theologians are concerned. The World Ayahuasca Conference then found out about this. They were organizing at the time, and they invited me to come in the summer, at the end of the summer in September 2014, and present on the fatwa, which was quite a great experience.
You, approaching it from a highly elevated spiritual context, not only got a fatwa from one of the highest offices in the land, but these are substances, as you say, which are entheogens. These are things like ayahuasca. Yeah. I mean, that must have been pretty incredible for you and your colleagues to hear that.
I really believed that he was going to brush us off. That was my, I basically said to them that we're going to just basically make fools of ourselves and they're going to brush us off. But, we didn't get responses from Ayatollah Sistani. They didn't even respond. But once we got to the seminary in Qom with Ayatollah Rouhani, their response was immediate. But they wanted to know everything. They wanted every detail. And we gave it to them. And at the end of the process, they said, no, there's no problem. It's halal from the point of view of fiqh. And now, let me remind you, this Ayatollah Rouhani is the author of a 40-plus volume work on fiqh that is now considered one of the standard Shia textbooks on the fiqh from the perspective of the sixth Shiite Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. And this book is very highly celebrated as being this great legal textbook of the modern times, written by a great Ayatollah like him, huge 40-plus volumes. But I should also add, this doesn't necessarily, a fatwa from the Holy Spirit doesn't necessarily have any influence on the government.
Right.
So Whereas, you know, the Hosa, the seminary has said, yeah, you know, I mean, you can do it and do it responsibly. It's okay from a religious point of view. That doesn't mean that the Iranian government is necessarily coming to the party on that score. So one still has to follow the precautions, as it were.
The fatwa itself said, yes, you can do this in a very specific context if there are qualified experts. Ahl al-ikhtisas. And you even said,
Ahl al-ikhtisas, yeah.
Yeah, and you even said, Wahid, you said that that kind of stipulation was vague. They didn't really explain what they meant by that. Is that right?
They didn't explain what that meant. But when you go back into the text and their own rulings, and what is the meaning of a mutakhassis, you know, someone who is a expert. I mean, in the contemporary context, that would be like a doctor is a physician. So he administers, you know, health to an ailing body. So, you know, a mutakhassis of entheogens, you know, in a Shia Iranian context is absent. So who are we talking about? We don't know any shamans, you know, like we have in the Amazon, other than, you know, these friends of mine that I mentioned in Mazen Daran, these Khaksar Sufis. That's my own speculation. Now, if that is the case, that's quite a nod by the Hosa to the Sufis, because these two, you know, realities are usually at loggerheads. You know, the seminary represents the law, the Sufis represents the spirituality, and never shall the twain meet, and they're always blocking heads. But, you know, in this particular case, in Qom, from a senior Ayatollah like Rouhani, it was like, yeah, it's, you know, seek the experts and you're okay.
Wow. Okay, so now you've opened the door beautifully to talking about the use of entheogens in specific contexts. But before we get there, I would love to talk to you, Wahid, about your specific order itself, the Fatimiyya order, the Sufi order. Can you just talk about, you were mentioning Ali as being, you know, of course, one of the Rashidun, one of the four righteous caliphs. But can you talk a little bit about historically this figure of Fatima radiallahu anha, how this figure played into your own decision to eventually become, you know, the founder of this order named after Fatima? Can you talk about that?
Yeah, certainly. When I was the night before I was initiated, I had a dream, and I've actually written about this in one of the interviews I did for Reality Sandwich, where it was night and it was a full moon and there was no one in Mecca. And I was at the Kaaba itself, and it was just me and the Kaaba itself. And the door of the Kaaba opened, and a female voice told me to come into the Kaaba in the dream. And it was a full moon. So I go in, and there seated in green with a white black headdress is Fatima Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And on the headdress, on the niqab, which was white, was written the word Al-Hayy, the living. And she told me to sit down, and next to her was the double-edged sword of Ali, the Dhul-Faqar. And she told me, open your mouth. And I did. And she took my tongue out and pierced my tongue with the double-edged sword of Ali, the Dhul-Faqar. And then instead of pain in this dream, I am then transported to a, you know, kind of a heaven celestial vision of a world of, there's just nothing but flakes of gold, you know, deserts of gold. And then the sun rises, and as the sun rises, the face of Fatima comes through the sun, now unveiled. And then the sun, as the higher it rises, it begins to take the form of a tree. And the more it takes the form of a tree, the more I start coming back into normal consciousness, and then I wake up and the sun is shining through my bedroom window. And I told my sheikh on the day of my initiation about the dream, and he says, you know, this is going to be the defining of your entire past from here on out. She has come to you and she has initiated you. So anything I do now is just a formality. One of the advice that he gave to me before he passed on is that, you know, follow the dream that you had on the night of your initiation. There is instruction here. So in 2005, within an ayahuasca session, she came and basically, you know, said that, you know, it is the time. And she made me recite a formula of the Shahada, which most Orthodox Muslims would consider to be very heretical, but it was La ilaha illallah, Fatima wajhullah. There is no God but God, and Fatima is the face of God. And she made me recite it 13 times, exactly 13 times. And after which he said, your work has now begun. And this was the ijazah that your sheikh gave you, so you must now initiate the Fatemiya. And I find it quite interesting, when you take Fatemiya and do the abjad of Fatemiya itself, it is 145. And 145 is also equivalent to two words. One is Sakina, which is the Arabic form of the word Shakina, and also the word, the attribute Muhayyimin, the protector, which is a synonym to that word that I gave you before, Kali, in Arabic.
Waheed, when you went through this incredibly transformative experience and you decided, okay, I'm going to this, I have been given the instructions, the divine instructions, I need to found this order, this Fatemiya Sufi order. How did that first go? Did you have people who were interested immediately? Where did you first set it up? Can you kind of walk us through the early days?
I did mini retreats after that ayahuasca experience. There was parts of the hinterland in Southeast Queensland, Australia, where I was living at the time, and I would do retreats of about 3 or 4, 7 days at a time. And then things kind of came together. You know, I was like, well, what do I do with this? Do I announce it? What do I do with this? And the dreams were very specific that you need to announce this. And there was one particular dream, and it was actually on the night of a solstice, it was the equinox. And I had the dream that I was being transported through the seven levels of being, and I came back again to Fatima, and she says, well, you know, this is the time you need to make the announcement, and here's a gift. And she gave me a prayer to memorize. And as I came back, I actually memorized the prayer, and that kind of became, the formula, as it were. And then it started very slowly coming together with a few people that are still with me, as a matter of fact.
Oh, wow. Wow. Okay. So with Fatima, radiyallahu anha, at the center of this, and as you say, with this powerful vision, you shared kind of the general beautiful elements of Sufism. You have, you know, dhikr, and you have al-hub, and you have attaining altered states of consciousness. Can you talk about kind of some
Sure.
of the central tenets?
Okay. The central tenet, we are interested in the inner aspect of the initiation itself, the esoteric of the esoteric. Now, Fatima represents the esoteric of the esoteric. If Ali is the Wali, if he represents the initiatic or the esoteric, then Fatima is the esoteric of the esoteric, because she is the confluence of the two oceans. Her father is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and her husband is the Wali, the providential guide, right?
That's beautiful.
So she is the glue between the two. There are hadith to that effect, at least Shiite versions of hadith that also exist in Sunni texts, where hadith Qudsi, where God says, you know, if it weren't for you, Muhammad, I would not have created the world. If it weren't for Ali, I wouldn't have created you. And if it weren't for Fatima, I wouldn't have created either of you. So she represents the Shekinah, as it were. You know, if you take that concept from the Kabbalah, then there is the Shekinah in Shiism, and it is Fatima. Personified, a theophany of a person, right? But the principle that is behind her is very much the same thing that you find in the Kabbalah in the understanding of the Shekinah is. At least in fact, the Shekinah in Kether and Bina as well.
When it comes to the use of entheogens, of psychedelics, things like ayahuasca, can you talk about the use, ritual use, initiatory use of those substances? What kind of role does that play in the Fatemiya Sufi order?
It is our sacrament, but we're not tripping all the time, because I think people need to prepare themselves for these experiences so they have the best possible experience in these states. I think that, deepening oneself with the dhikr and the visualizations and the prayers on a daily basis is far more anchoring ultimately when one approaches these experiences, rather than, going into, every Saturday night with a shaman and drinking either for healing purposes or whatever else. While healing is a very important component of an initiatic experience, it's the ascent, the increase in knowledge. about the nature of reality that I think is the more important thing. Because knowledge is what also heals. You know, the more you know, the more you have the power to heal yourself. And you're not a patient. You're an actor in that situation when you are knowing. But knowledge is also, ilm is also a divine attribute. It is, you know, in fact, in Shia theology, the two primary attributes of God that are coeval with the essence of God is one, knowledge and power. That's interesting that in the Amazon, one of the components of the ayahuasca divine is called the power. And knowledge and light are synonymous. You can take them as synonymous attributes of God. So, you know, the DMT being the light is also the knowledge. So these two, the power and the light, or the knowledge, when they come together, not only heal, but then expand a person and allow the individual to engage in an alchemical process within themselves, both within the entheogenic reality or the hyperspace of the entheogenic experience or the imaginal landscape, as I call it, with a capital I, that then allows people to then build the alchemical body in the mundane, spatiotemporal, everyday mundane experience.
In Judaism, we hear the story of Moses and the burning bush, and well, that had that had psychoactive properties. There was the book in Christianity about, the mushroom and the cross that Jesus was really just a name for a kind of cult. Is there anything in the history of Islam that might that might hint at that kind of use? Okay,
you know, I haven't seen anything published, but I had a conversation with an individual very steeped in pre-Islamic Arab lore, an academic, and he swore me to the secrecy not to reveal his name. And I don't understand why he did that, but he was of the opinion that, and even now he says he's found evidence of this, that in certain parts of Mecca, around that area of Mount Hira, there is evidence of fungi, of certain fungi. Now he said if there are camels and goats in that area, at certain times of the year, it is very possible that you will have certain mushroom species growing in that place. His speculation is that it's very possible that there are endogenous and indigenous psychoactive mushroom species that grow in the desert. It's just that we don't know about them. So he was trying to make that connection that it is very possible that the origins of Islam itself have some connection to psychoactive plants. Now, in the hadith of the imams that also then are transmitting hadith from the Prophet himself, there are numerous hadith that sing the virtues of the Syrian rue, the esfanta in Iran, about how important it is to burn this, to ingest it, that a house that carries the esfanta Syrian rue, the devils stay 40 paces away from it. This is an identical belief that the ancient Zoroastrians had about this plant. Many other plants are mentioned. DMT-containing plants are aplenty in that region of the world, whether through the acacia or in the jungly parts of, like, for example, in Turkey and Iran, you have the mimosa. But the DMT is everywhere in that region of the world. I mean, I've had friends of mine who have spent some time with the Bedouins in Jordan, and they say that there is a red species of the Assyrian rue that only seems to grow in certain parts of the Jordanian desert, and these Bedouins know them very well, and they chew these, and they're extremely psychoactive, but it's just the rue itself. And this friend of mine apparently chewed one of these one time, and he said that he was having a full-blown, you know, experience, and there was no DMT, but he was in the DMT world by chewing these.
I had someone tell me that if there are indigenous, say, fungi or certain plant species in, you know, the greater area around, as you said, around the Kaaba, around Mecca, al-Mukarrama, with the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was meditating in a cave when this happened.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, without getting, you know, crazily controversial, this is just something that's being discussed. But yes, I mean, when you think of certain elements or certain fungi that may or may not be in a cave, and then you have this revelation and Jibreel is there and the wings stretch from horizon to horizon. Yes. Do you think that also could play a role in some of the visionary aspects, whether it's seeing Jibreel for the first time or whether, of course, you know, taking the Burak all the way up from Al-Quds, you know, ascending to seven heavens? Can you talk about that?
Sure. I mean, but let's also remind people that these experiences are also possible outside of the context of taking an entheogenic plant. You could sit in meditation and zikr for, you know, 12, 13 hours. And, you know, with the grace of the Almighty, you can have these sorts of experiences as well. But the initial experiences of these great prophet sages, I am convinced that there are these components involved. And these components are involved because they are fundamentally the gifts of heaven itself. You know, when the spirits want to call somebody, there's always a plant involved, whether there's a tree there or there's some other kind of plant in all the sacred literature of the world. All religions, there's always a plant somewhere. The Buddha's under the Bodhi tree, the burning bush in Sinai with Moses. There's also trees in the Quran, the tree that the people of Medina give bayat to the Prophet, you know, that basically saves Islam from its enemies. The foliage, trees, plants, they're everywhere in these religions. Now, even if these scriptures don't talk very overtly about, you know, taking a psychoactive plant, nevertheless, the plant world, as in my belief and in the belief of many shamans, too, is the kind of the receptor to the other side, as it were, or at least other side from our point of view, from the point of view of human beings, because it's already here anyway. It's all part of the same continuum.
You mentioned that there are many other ways without the aid of entheogens that one can attain an altered state of consciousness. You mentioned deep meditation. I know shamanistically fasting is a very big thing. Yeah. Rhythmic dancing. I think I even read accounts of someone, you know, people will...
Hyperventilation.
Yes.
Breathing. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, exactly. So from the perspective of your order, of the Fatimiyya order, do you think that all of these different techniques of attaining an altered state of consciousness, that even though entheogens are obviously central to your order, that if someone were able to attain these states without entheogens, that as long as they're getting to the same place that you want them to get, that's okay? Or do entheogens...
Yeah, that's okay. That's perfectly okay. In fact, I'm encouraging people that work with me to keep the entheogens just for the gatherings that we have with the sacrament, but that to work more with the zikrs and work more with the prayers and the visualizations, because these things really ground and they really allow the experience to be processed properly, where the real information and the downloads can descend in a very clear way for people.
And that ties into something that you've touched on before, which is magic, or sihr in Arabic. And I know this is something you're extremely familiar with. I think a lot of people in the listening audience will benefit from this. There seems to be, like in many traditions, a kind of tension between two sides of the magical spectrum. On one side that you've touched on, you have what would be considered high-level white magic, for lack of a better term, or theurgistic magic, ruhaniya, literally meaning
spirituality. Yeah.
Yes. And on the other side of that, you have the kind of magic known in the Quran as sihr, which is could be considered goetic or even kafanic. So, Sheikh, can you talk about the difference between sihr and ruhaniya and just where they lie?
Okay. We have to take this on a couple of different levels. On the very basic level, on the theological level, the text, the Quran is very explicit. You know, there's sihr and there's ruhaniya. The definition of ruhaniya as white magic actually comes from a verse in the 17th surah of the Quran, where, you know, they're asking the Prophet, you know, what is the nature of the spirit? And he says, the spirit is from the command of my Lord, al-ruh, amri rabbi. And this is the definition that a lot of magicians, high magicians, Buni included, have used consistently to denote what their craft is, what the art is. Goetic magic would be the kind of conjuration of the style, at least archetypally, that we read in the Quran about the sorcerers of Pharaoh, for example, against Moses, you know.
Yeah.
However, with all of this said, you know, once we come into that world itself, and then also then balance this all out with, you know, the high imamology, there is a point where theurgy and goetia start to become the same thing, right? And I say this, you know, and before, you know, certain brothers start to condemn me as of tomorrow, the imam, in the texts of Hayyam Imamology and Shi'ism, is both the master of that stands at the gateway of heaven, and he's also the master that stands at the gateway of hell. He commands 12 legions. And even in the Quran, we don't have demons guarding the gates of hell. It is angels. There's 19 angels, according to the Quran, that are there standing at the gates of hell. Once one begins to get deeper into this tradition, the difference between Goetic and Theurgy begins to blur. However, I will say this. I think it is important for people who get into this from a Muslim background or from the point of view of Islam to first immerse themselves for some years, maybe even 20, 30 years in the Theurgy, ground themselves in the vicar, until they start to venture and start playing around with jinn and afarit and etc. Because anyone who has been in this world long enough knows that if you venture without experience into the world of these other chthonic beings, that there are bargains that people make that may disturb their lives and the lives of other people around them. And there are consequences. There's a consequence to these sorts of things. And people should be responsible. So it is better for one to ground oneself in the high magic first. Once that is, one has mastered that to some level, one should maybe, if just for understanding the nature of the other side, maybe venture into that other side, but only with the protection of the Allah. Buni has a very wonderful discussion in the shorter version of the Shams al-Ma'arif at the very beginning of this book, where he basically gives a rundown of the cosmology of the worlds in a very succinct form. He makes a statement in there that both hell and all these different worlds in the chthonic world are all linked in the great chain of being to the upper world. This is all creations of the one God. So, we're not dealing with an adversary who's an adversary to God. God doesn't have an adversary from at least the hysteric Islamic point of view. The All-High has no adversaries. The devil is the adversary of man, not the adversary of God, who controls all sides, basically. But for the protection of people and also, the responsibility involved in the craft, that people should first perfect one craft before venturing into the other. And this in itself is quite a journey.
It was just amazing hearing you delineate those differences, because one thinks in the Western esoteric context of the Goetia, for example. If you're going to attempt some kind of quote-unquote demonic or chthonic interaction, it stipulates that in many places you must have the protection of, or at least the engagement of, certain thwarting angels or angelic spirits before you even think about stepping inside a consecrated circle.
It's also the case in Islamic magical tradition as well.
Wahid, one of the things that I think sets Islam apart, and again, please correct me if I'm wrong, is that in the Christian context, for example, it's very binary. There's angels and there's demons, and that's it. And angels are good and demons are bad, and you need to go to church and that's it. But Islam has this entire third dimension of the jinn. And these beings of fire, and unlike Shaitan or Iblis being an angel in the Christian Judaic context, of course in the Islamic context is a jinn, is a being of fire who wouldn't bow down to Adam, because he said, well, wait a second, خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين, you created me from fire and you created this
Adam creature.
So can you talk about that, Wahid, in terms of the more open landscape, or at least the allowance in Islam of a other dimension of reality with the jinn that is not there in the Christian context?
Well, the other realities mentioned in the surah, the surah of the jinn itself is addressing the jinn. So immediately within the Quranic cosmology, we have another dimension besides the human dimension and the divine dimension, this in between the two. The jinn come in many different species. I think one of the ways that one could probably contextualize them in a similar Western context is that a lot of the elementals, like, for example, the elemental beings that we have of the air, fire, water, earth, also there are jinns within. There are jinn of water, there are jinn of fire, there are jinn of the element of earth and air, etc., within the Islamic magical text as well. So this is basically what we're talking about. And then there are familiars, the Qarina, you know, which is another subspecies of jinn.
If you're a high-level Sufi practitioner, let's say, would it be proper or allowed for a high-level Sufi practitioner to engage in sihr, in more materialistic aims, if the intentions are good? For example, more material wealth, more, you know, to protect a family member, or is the focus simply on the ruhaniyah?
Well, that isn't really called sihr in that context. I mean, in Iran, you can still go to the old bazaars and go see your local occultist, and they'll write you a spell. You know, I want to fall in love with so and so to fall in love with me, and they will write you a spell and give you the instructions, and away you go. That still exists in Iran. Maybe not in other parts of the Arab Islamic world, but I've also seen it in parts of Indonesia where this is still going on. But this is not called sihr. Sihr is goetic. It's malevolent. You know, you want to kill somebody or hurt the entire family of people, or that then starts to venture into the realm of sihr. But with some conversations I've had with some very seasoned occultists in Iran, they believe that if you use the Rouhaniya, for example, against malevolent people, that still is not sihr.
Ah, okay. So if you're using it where something ill or bad is happening to a person who themselves is a bad person, then in that case, it's not considered sihr. Okay.
And that is an opinion, though. I mean, it's a controversial opinion, but that is an opinion that many Sufis in Iran have. Yeah, and many occultists in Iran.
I know, Waheed, obviously, you know countless examples of sihr from the Quran, but one of them that's coming to mind right now, I'm not sure why, and I'm totally going to mess this up, but in Surah 113, Surah Al-Falaq, when it talks about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ
مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقُ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ النَّفَّاثَاتِ فِي
الْعُقَدِ, and please protect me from the mischief of the women who blow on knots.
Can you
talk about this? Because I think for some of our listeners who are familiar with quote-unquote village magic or black magic, quote-unquote, can you talk about what is this whole thing about women blowing on knots and their relation to harm the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
The part about the Prophet being harmed, this is a narrative that is accepted by Sunnis but is rejected by Shia Muslims. So let me just clarify that. In ancient Arabia or pre-Islamic Arabia, the kahina or the soothsayer, female soothsayer, had a practice where they took a knot and they blew on it with the name of a victim and hid it in a well. And the victim would die, or their family would be destroyed, or they were get a sickness, whatever. The Sunni narrative is that there was a Jewish kahina in Medina that blew on a knot that she buried in a well that made the Prophet sick. And some Sunni narratives believe that it was this this incident that was finally responsible for the death of the Prophet himself. The Shia reject this narrative. Nevertheless, the surah itself was revealed by the archangel as a formula for the believer to recite whenever they believe that there is black magic involved in something going on in their life. Within the Quran itself, that Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas, the one after it, are not the only instances where the text of the Quran itself is offering a remedy against black magic and sorcery.
Which means
that implicitly that the book accepts the reality of magic and sorcery. It's a magical universe that we're dealing with in the Quran.
One of the things too, speaking about magic in the Quran, or the discussion of magic in the Quran, is an example which you mentioned, Waheed, that it's not too prevalent, but it is in there, and I'm wondering if we can talk about it just for a brief minute about the two angels, Harut and Marut, in Surah Al-Baqarah, or the second surah of the Quran. And this I just found fascinating because, and I'm probably totally not understanding or remembering the context, but I remember reading it, Wahid, and I thought, okay, there are these two angels, Harut and Marut. These are not jinn, they're not shaitan. These are angels saying, oh, people of Babylon, I think it was, you know, we will teach you magic. If you really want to come to us, we will teach you magic, but please know that the very fact that we're here is a test from your God, Allah.
From your God, yeah.
Can you talk about that?
If you take us by our word, then you have failed the test.
Wow. And it seems that Harut and Marut, by the definition that you just gave, Wahid, were offering to teach magic, but they're not offering to teach ruhaniyah. This is sihr. This is stuff that can hurt people.
Hurt, and it's about power, material power. And so this is the context of the story, that the God sends these two angels to the people of Babylon to teach, you know, to test them for their faith, and they all fail it by taking these angels at their words. It is not a concept of a fallen angel. There are certain there's been a lot of debate about Harut and Marut in the theological literature for a long time. You know, whether they are fallen angels, whether we can fit them into the, you know, the Enochian, the Book of Enoch narrative about fallen angels. No, they're not fallen angels. In fact, even in a lot of Ash'ari theological texts, they take them as messengers of the All-High. Nadirum is, you know, so they are warners. But they're warners that have this side of them that they're, you know, they're telling people that, you know, we're here to mislead you, and the test is whether you will be misled or not.
Wow.
In other contexts, I've also read texts where Harut and Marut are defined as angel demons. So they're the two angels that have their feet in both worlds, both Jahannam and Jannah.
Does that kind of lead to the point that you made a couple minutes ago about when you start with a sihr and the ruhaniya perspective, if you keep going up and up and up, eventually these two become very close.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, they become the same.
When it comes to Sufism and magic, can you talk about something that you referenced earlier about the Islamic Seven Seals of Solomon, which is also known as the greatest name? Yes, I think our listeners who are familiar with the Western grimoiric system, whenever they hear of the Seal of Solomon from the Goetia, or how to make certain seals or talismans or symbols, they would be fascinated by the Seven Seals of Solomon. Can you share about that?
Yeah, I mean, the seal comes from a poem of Ali, the first Shia Imam. Let me actually just get the poem itself. There's currently a lot of dispute and discussion among scholars about the about the origins of this symbol. But from the Shiite point of view, and even Sufis accept this, this symbol was found during a time, I think during the Battle of the Camel, when Ali was caliph at the point, and he found the symbol on a rock. Then they asked him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, what does this mean? And the poem came, three sticks in a row after a seal, above them the semblance of a straightened lance, then a blind mim, this is the Arabic letter mim, then a blind mim without a tail, then a ladder unto all that is hoped for, but which is not a ladder. Four things, like fingers in a row, pointing to good deeds, but without a wrist. And then a ha, the Arabic letter ha, that has been split, then an inverted wow, like the siphon of a phlebotomist, the cup of a bloodletter, but not a bloodletting cup. This is the name whose worth is magnified. If you were ignorant of it before, you know it now. O bearer of the great name, take sufficiency in it. You shall be preserved from misfortunes and shall be kept safe. It is the secret name of God. May his glory be glorified unto all men, be they Arab or non-Arab. And this seal basically is seven sigils. The first one beginning usually with a pentagram, and then three sticks in a row, and then above them a straight line, and then a blind Arabic letter mim, then a symbol that looks like a ladder, then four sticks of four alifs, Arabic alifs in a row, then a split ha that looks like a head of a person, and then an inverted Arabic letter waw. This is the greatest thing. This is the supreme symbol of the Islamic theurgic tradition. But what is interesting is that there was a lot of cross-pollinization during the medieval period, and this symbol also finds its way into capitalistic Judaism. If, for example, if you look at the edition of the Sefer Yetzirah done by Arya Kaplan, there's a version of these seven seals in that book, and also in his Meditation and Kabbalah. And within the various Geniza magical manuscripts that people like Gideon Bohack have now started to study intensely, these symbols show up. But most of these texts, these Jewish Hebrew texts, are from pretty much the 12th, 13th century of the Common Era onwards. So that the understanding amongst scholars is that this symbol found its way into Judaism from Islam. There is some discussion that perhaps there was a hekalot precedent for these symbols, because symbols very similar to it have been found amongst the Greek magical papyri, and you know the question of whether there was cross-pollinization between you know whoever produced these Greek magical papyri and the hekalot literature you know is happening in the academy. So, but anyway, from the Islamic point of view, this symbol is transmitted first by Ali, the first imam.
Ah, that is fascinating. Now, when it comes to the proper approach and use of this symbol, obviously, you know, you mentioned one of the aspects, the highest aspects of Sufism is dhikr, and also using the names, the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah. So if this is known as the greatest name, there are seven different sigils, seven different characters there. Can you talk about how does this name fit into that?
Although the tradition itself with Ali and the Shia Imams don't specify what names are attached to these sigils specific, the later tradition, especially with the transmission that Buni then kind of becomes the main figure of, there are seven names associated, and also seven demons and jinn that are also associated with the angels that are associated with the symbols. The speculation was that these seven seals are also then associated with the Sawakit. These are the seven letters that don't occur in the Al-Fatiha, the first surah of the Quran, which are the letter Fa, Jim, Shin, Fa, Dha, Kha, and Za, right? But this does not come from the Shia tradition. This is we're now entering the magical tradition proper. So these Sawakit, the letters of the Sawakit, then would be associated, for example, with the first seal. So the seal of the pentagram, or sometimes you find the hexagram, is associated with the letter Fa, and is the divine name Fat, the single. The second one would be the letter Jim, and that would be the name Jabbar. Next one would be Shin, Shakur, the one to whom all praise is due. The next one would be Thabit, the fixed, the permanent. The next one would be Zahir, the manifest. The one after that, the letter Kha, is Khabir, the well-informed. And the final one would be Zaki, the pure. This is the magical tradition. This is not coming from the Shia tradition. Then there are seven angels associated with each of these names. So the first would be the angel Ruqya'il, or Ruqya'il in proper Kabbalistic universe. Next one would be Jibra'il, or Gabriel. The angel after that is Samsama'il. Now, there's dispute whether this is Sema'il, which is the devil, or is it Shemra'il? This is the dispute that happens in this tradition. The one after that would be associated with the angel Mikael, or Michael. Then the one after that is associated with the angel Israfil or Sarfiail, Raphael. Then the next one would be associated with the angel Anyail or Anael. And the final one is the angel Kasfiail or Kasfial. Angels, apparently in the magical tradition, the conventional understanding in the magical tradition, the angels that are associated with each of these seven sigils.
In your specific practice, Waheed, are these sigils referred to?
We meditate on these sigils in the same way, for example, someone would meditate on the Yom.
you meditate on them, you incorporate them into your meditations, your dhikr, and from there, spiritual insights can be gained by meditating on them.
Wow. Lucid dreaming, the whole works with the symbol,
To continue down this magical vein, something that is our listeners, I think, would find very fascinating is you are also helping rejuvenate the interest in Arabic grimoires, Islamic world grimoires, and esoteric texts, and expanding it for the Western audience. And to that end, I'm primarily referring to a translation that you did from Arabic into English of parts of the 13th century Arabic grimoire, the Kitabu Shams al-Ma'arif wal-Lata'if al-A'warif, or the Book of the Sun of Gnosis and the Subtleties of Elevated Things, is a book attributed allegedly, and I want to get into this because, as you mentioned, it's pretty much been debunked, but if you go online right now, you will see that this 13th century Arabic grimoire and certain elements of it is attributed to the Sufi Sheikh Ahmed bin Ali al-Buni in Egypt. Can you, Waheed, talk about this seminal work in terms of its importance, and really what made you want to translate and delve into this specific grimoire?
Well, I've actually abandoned my translation because there's been critical texts coming of the various corpus texts of the Corpus Buniano in recent years, where I've actually put aside the printed editions that are pretty much worthless. And I've acquired quite a trove of these manuscripts myself, and I've been looking through them, and it's a huge job. But all kudos to people like Jean-Charles Coulon of the Sorbonne, who put out this 3,000-plus page doctoral dissertation in 2013, where a good chunk of his dissertation was establishing critical texts of what the Corpus Buniano is. So what was the closest that we can get of what the Shams al-Ma'arif would have been at the time of Buni and some of the other lesser works of al-Buni. Now, there are three in the later manuscript tradition, so we're talking about from the 15th century onward, there are three different strands of the Shams al-Ma'arif. There's the Shams al-Ma'arif al-Sukhra, the lesser Shams al-Ma'arif, then the Wusta, Shams al-Ma'arif al-Wusta, the middle one, and then the Shams al-Ma'arif al-Kubra, which is basically a grimoire that other peoples have added to, with maybe about a third or less of it being the original work of al-Buni. The scholarly consensus now is that a majority of these works that have been attributed to Buni, and especially large chunks of the Shams al-Ma'arif al-Kubra, would have been items introduced by an Iranian Sufi who was working in the Ottoman court by the name of Abdurrahman Bistami. And he's also a author of many occult works in his own right. So the consensus is that this larger version of the Kubra is the grimoire that kind of flowered, under his head. And, I think he's an important figure in his own right, but this is not al-Buni's Shams al-Ma'arif. The original Shams al-Ma'arif is a shorter work, and there were some smaller works that Buni also composed. The Berhatia conjuration oath, or the text of it that I translated originally back in 2008, the understanding now is that this commentary and the text of it was not written by al-Buni at all. And in fact, in this critical edition of the Corpus Bunianum that Mr. Coulon did, you will not find either the commentary on the Jaljalutia, which is another important text, a poem, and also the Berhatia. But the Berhatia is a very important text. It has very big problems. And the more I am delving deeper and deeper into the manuscripts, I find more and more problems with this text. It's supposedly a Syriac crypto-Hebrew invocation, the meat of it being these 28 names that occur in about the second or third paragraph of the conjuration that are crypto-Syriac, that are supposed to be invoking names of God, that then simultaneously are invoking both angelic presences and also jinn as well as demons at the same time. It is attributed, to have a long antiquity. The text itself claims that it goes back to the times of the Babylonians, and actually refers to the gate of the Temple of Greatness. But, from a scholarly point of view, from a historical point of view, there are reasons to be incredulous about this claim. what I have traced to the Berhatia, I think where the Berhatia probably originates is somewhere around the early 10th, middle of the 11th century, and particularly in a text of an Iranian occultist, an astrologer, by the name of Al-Tapsi, in a work called Hisham al-Fi Bahr al-Kamal, where the whole book is basically is about conjuration. And the vast majority of this text by Al-Tapsi is devoted to pseudo-Hebrew conjurations, and also what he claims to be conjurations in Greek. And then there are names that appear probably in about 200 pages into the manuscript that are eerily close to the names of the Berhatia. So this is where most likely that the Berhatia originated, with this text of Al-Tapsi. Because we cannot find any references to this text until probably about the 11th, 12th centuries of the Common Era.
We'll make sure to put a link to the video that you did, because your recitation of it, even given that historical context, the way that you do it, Wahid, just sends shivers down someone's spine. I mean, and for those magicians who are listening in the Western esoteric context, can you talk about some of the similarities between the Berhatia oath and certain elements of magic? For instance, in the Berhatia oath, you are using names of power. You are invoking the angels to protect you and to execute certain magical orders. There seems to be that kind of magical component big time in the Berhatia oath.
Yeah, and not just in the Berhatia. In all of these various conjuration oaths, even Al-Buni, the same formula and paradigm is basically going on, where you're asking an angel, higher forces, to do certain things for you. This is pretty much the deal throughout the entire tradition as a whole.
Can you just kind of share, Wahid, just from your perspective, if someone is out there and they are genuinely interested in, you know, either English translations or actual what you would consider legitimate, you know, historical grimoires in the Islamic world, can you point them in a direction or two that you might recommend?
Well, there's a gentleman in Canada. I say this with a few warnings, but he has put out some good work, him and his partner. I'm speaking of the gentleman known as Ninva Shatrak and his partner Francis Harrison. My only issue with the material that they have put out is that they are following two closely printed editions. When they do manuscripts, these are manuscripts that need a little bit more critical work than what they've done. But for a general audience, I think it is, you know, especially people who are coming out of a Thelemic or a Golden Dawn, if they really want to look at this universe from a non-scholarly point of view, I think the works of Ninba Shadrach and Francis Harrison are a good place to go to.
Someone who has made history, literally, in Iran, and someone who has founded your own Sufi order, can you just talk about, Wahid, in your estimation, for people on the outside who might not know too much about it, what are the two or three big things that people might not understand about esoteric Sufism or Sufism in general? And, or I guess said another way, what are the two or three things that you really wish people would understand, or you find yourself having to explain again and again, that you just really wish people would remember about Sufism in general and the importance of this incredible tradition?
Well, in the Muslim world itself, you know, we constantly have to remind our fellow Muslim and Muslim, our brothers and sisters, that not all Sufis are antinomians, and especially amongst the Shia Sufis, that not every sheikh or qutb is necessarily trying to replace the Ahlul Bayt. Outside of the Muslim world, what we have to remind people is that Islam is not a monolithic tradition, and that there are many different facets and tendencies in the tradition, and many different rivulets, if you would. And at this time right now, where the Islamophobia in the West has reached an endemic level, you have to remind people that not every Muslim out there is an Islamist and a terrorist, and there are people that maybe you would like to know, you know, or Muslims whose conception of the deen is very different than what the media is telling you.
Oh my goodness, yes. I can't tell you how many stories, Wahid, that I've had from either colleagues or friends who they, you know, watch all of the cable news shows, and they have this very negative impression of the entire Muslim world just from, you know, a few TV clips. But then they totally change their minds when they find out about that incredibly rich tradition. Waheed, we really appreciate your time. Is there any other information, Waheed, that you want listeners to know about yourself or where to find you or where to continue learning if they themselves have an interest in...
Not about myself. I would like to read to your listeners.
Sure.
One of the most important koans of the entire esoteric tradition. This is a very short dialogue about ultimate reality by Imam Ali and his disciple Kumail. This is called the Hadith Kumail or the Hadith al-Haqiqa, the Hadith of ultimate reality, because I think this kind of shows, you know, in a nutshell, what the tradition is really about. Like such, the Imam and Kumail are riding through the desert, and Kumail turns to Ali, his master, and he says, "Oh, Commander of the Faithful, what is ultimate reality?" And Ali turns around, you know, "What have you and ultimate reality to do with each other?" And Kumail says back, "Oh, Commander of the Faithful, is it not the case that I'm already sharing your secrets as your companion?" Ali says, "Yes, indeed. But that which sprinkles unto you is billowing through me unto you." So Kumail asks, "Oh, Commander of the Faithful, what is ultimate reality? Mal haqiqa?" And Ali looks at him and says, "The disclosure of the majesties of glorification without indication." And Kumail asks, "Please explain further, O Commander of the Faithful." And Ali says, "The negation of all speculation and the realization of that which can be realized." And Kumail says, "Please tell me more." Ali responds, "The nullificative annihilation of the secret by the victorious rending of the veil off the mystery of the secret." Kumail says, "Please tell me more." Ali responds, "The attraction of the divine oneness by the attribute of apprehension of the divine unicity." Kumail asks again, "Please elucidate further, O Commander of the Faithful." Ali says, "A light illuminating from the dawn of pre-eternity and shedding its traces upon the tablets of the talismanic temples of unicity." And Kumail asks again, "O Commander of the Faithful, tell me more." Ali says, "Extinguish the lamp, for the dawn has indeed arisen."
Shivers down my spine, Waheed. Wow.
That is the Hadith Kumail.
Wow. I truly think that that is a beautiful way to end this podcast. Cannot thank you enough, Sheikh Waheed Azhar, the founder of the Fatlamiya Sufism Order. Thank you so much for taking the time and joining us on the podcast.
My pleasure.
And thank you for listening to this episode of the Glitch Bottle Podcast and helping us uncork the uncommon this fine day or night or wherever you happen to occupy space-time in your occult lairs, your summoning towers, or your cloistered libraries of the esoterically awesome. You can check out previous episodes and other magical Glitch Bottle news on YouTube, youtube.com/glitchbottle, and subscribe and download free episodes anytime on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and on Spreaker.com. Just search Glitch Bottle and enjoy. Also, please make sure to subscribe and follow us on Twitter at Glitch Bottle, all one word. Our intro music is the track Tornado by David Zeste. Our magical interest is fueled by sincerity, passion, amazing guests, and a copious amount of clinking coffee cups. Until next time, this is Alexander Eth reminding you to invoke often, uncork the uncommon, and keep the light.